Talking about the demographics of the farm, we have four generations. The first generation wasn't the pioneers who arrived on the buses. It was their parents who came 10 years later when they saw their kids had a pretty good thing going. And then the pioneers, and then the children born all through the 70s and 80s. And now the fourth generation is the children born to those children. And my granddaughter is now in farm school. When I left home, it was Halloween, I was just watching her go out trick-or-treating. We're aging, but we're aging with a little more style. This is our disc golf course, 18 holes. We have triathlons and bike races and various different sporting events and music. And if you're around long enough, you end up with one of these. It's part of being a fully featured settlement. And we have, a cemetery too. Partly we're still there. I think Mother Earth News came and saw us in the 1980s and said the reason they're still there is because they have a foreign policy. They actually give to people outside of themselves. And that's actually a very astute point, because if you're thinking about larger problems than just your own self is on automatic. You're taking care of yourself just fine, and you're thinking about the bigger issues. So for us, it came out of the ham radio when we were listening one night, and we had this earthquake in Guatemala in 1974, and 20,000 people killed, and not very much help reaching the villages in the highlands. And we said, what can we do about that? They were calling for help on the ham radio. So we sent a few people down, a couple of paramedics, and they came back and they said, it's one thing to call yourself a voluntary peasant, but there's a big difference between voluntary peasants and involuntary peasants. If you are a voluntary peasant and something goes wrong, you can go back to your parents or go back to college or whatever. And if you're an involuntary peasant and something goes wrong, you die. And a lot of people are about to die in Guatemala from bad water and no houses and the rainy season coming and all this contagion that's coming after the earthquake. And we actually have it pretty good here on a dollar a day in Tennessee. We're living off a very fat, rich country, and we're living off of the waste of that country. This became a debate within the farm, and it was, I think, a turning point in our history. And it was the point at which we said, do we finish the water line down to this third road, or do we send some food down to Guatemala? And at that point, we made the decision to begin massive shipments of aid and sending things across Mexico, working with the Mennonites and others, and then filling up this bus with soybeans, sending it down to Mexico on 23-cent gallon diesel. And then we sent people down there who were carpenters and helped rebuild. And this is actually, our learning curve, because you can see that it's always going to have earthquakes. That's an active volcano in the background. And so the building's massive masonry is going to shake. It's rigid and going to come down a big club lump. If you put in this pine with triangulated joints and plywood, it's bending. And you hear the screeching of the nails as they pull. It's like fingernails going across a chalkboard. And it wakes you up. So you run out of the house, and then the house comes down. It's not earthquake proof, but it's earthquake resistant. And, basic Buckminster Fuller tetrahedron principles here. And setting up jigs in Guatemala where the power was and making prefab houses and then sending those up into the countryside. And people come to the farm, and they would look at the houses on the farm that were made out of army tents and buses. And they'd say, how come you're not Oroville? How come you're not New Vrindavan? Where's your monumental architecture here for Utopia? And we would say, well, you want to see what we built? Go to Guatemala, where we built 3,000 homes and 300 public buildings in the space of 10 years. And you look at the municipalidad today, and the people there were so proud of the municipalidad that this is in Solala, they painted the murals of the Popol Vuh on the walls so they could, tell their stories to their children. So there we are in country, and we have, you know, this woman and this woman are both about the same age. She's holding her fresh one soybean baby. She's probably had 6 children, and 3 of them die before the age of 5, because that's the average. And why are they the different height? It's not genetics. It has to do with childhood nutrition. It has to do with water supply and parasites, lots of reasons. So when we, you know, working there, sometimes people would bring us our babies. Sometimes we could save them, sometimes we can't. My next door neighbor is one of the babies we saved. And, you know, you learn, one of the things you learn is that a lot of the protein supply was wiped out by the Spanish conquest. And if you reinsert grain amaranth and some of the things that they made before, you can, this is a weed in Tennessee, it's a weed in Michigan too, amaranth, you know. But if you reinsert this down there, it's a very valuable protein source. And so we started doing World Health Organization field trials and things, working to introduce soy through ice cream, and to get soy dairy started to get the protein levels up. This is soy dairy starting. The reason that this soy dairy actually survived through the Guatemalan Holocaust years was first in line here, opening day, was La Guardia Nacional. They like their ice cream. There's nothing that's going to happen to that plant. So we put out a call for help. And the people would show up with the aceron, the Guatemalan bulldozer, this giant hoe. And they would dig, 7 kilometers through rocky volcanic soil to the highlands where they could get water through cisterns. And then that would come down. This is a 3-village water project, so there's 6 pipes going down with 1 redundant pipe for each village. And you'd have the 3-village water project like this. Well, the problem is when the Reagan administration comes in, this is the definition of communism. There's nobody paying for this water. And so here's another thing that's communist. Native language radio. Radio Kikotan, la voz de Salala, which is like spinning salsa and stuff and talking in Cachiquel language. And yeah, but communist, obviously. So when the government changes, first in Washington and then in Guatemala, suddenly the whole thing changes. And we go from doing integrated development work in food and nutrition and midwifery and water systems and so forth to rescuing people crossing through the Lacandon jungle leading an underground railroad into refugee camps in Chiapas. 250,000 refugees. And it changed forever the politics of Mexico. And Stephen Gaskin flew into this refugee camp with a Piper Cub dodging stumps to deliver medical supplies. And he handed out crayons and paper to the kids and said, draw what you remember of your village. And this is what they drew. They don't make helicopters in Guatemala. And so, you see something like this and you say, what can we do? It's our country. What can we do? So one of the things you notice is they have, they're still making the traditional traje, this traditional clothing that signifies their individual village. And they're telling the tales that go with the stories that go with those clothing. So for instance, there's a fabric called Galactica, which is you tie-dye the threads first and then you weave them together and it forms star patterns, and the star patterns are the opportunity for the mother to tell the daughter about the Popol Vuh and about how the corn god dropped the corn from the sky and how it landed on the ground and fed the people. So if they're allowed to continue that, they keep their culture. So providing them the basics for dyes and things like that became the key. And so working with Oxfam, working with fair trade networks around the world, setting up the Artesanas Maya, the One World Trading Company, we're able to begin to provide a source of income, and weavers co-ops spring up in the refugee camps and begin to provide the means for which to provide for the needs of the refugee camps, since the Mexican government was very good at keeping out the Red Cross. So now you had some self-sufficiency. This picks up and gets carried by another 800 co-ops around the Native American world, the Navajo, the Zapotec. Others are starting to feed into this, Pueblo de People, Oxfam, and so forth, picking up the trade goods. This becomes a whole movement of Indigenous Women's Economic Development, or IWED. It's a project of plenty. Plenty is our organization. It comes from the word in abundancia in Spanish, but the word in English comes from something Gandhi said. He said, there's not enough for everybody's greed, but there is enough for everybody's need. In fact, there's plenty. So we're plenty. And we say there is plenty. You just need to reorganize a little bit. When we could no longer be in Guatemala because we were a threat to the people by educating them, and anybody educated could become a target, we had to pull out all our people, and so we spread them around. They started going to Lesotho and Nicaragua, St. Lucia, and doing projects in appropriate technology in various ways in various places. We had a sailing ship that went around the Caribbean. This is kind of the start of our sail transport network. Plug for the sail transport network. This is going to revitalize the sailing commerce in the Lake Lanier, Interlaken, Traverse City area, I promise you. So we also started the Bronx Ambulance Service. This was where we saw, you know, there was a shortage of medical provision in the South Bronx. Am I all right on time, or should I wrap it up? I'm speaking as fast as I can, but there's a lot of slides here. Okay, so you got the South Bronx falling apart. It looks like Hiroshima. You've got squatted buildings, abandoned buildings, people burning, landlords burning down their buildings just to collect the insurance. A whole place, whole blocks of the South Bronx just disappearing. So we sent up a busload of hippies and an ambulance. And we started an ambulance service and squatted a building in the South Bronx. Put a bat cave in the basement. Set up ham radio antennas on the roof. Monitored all the wavelengths of all the city emergency services. If the police got a call, we could be on the scene in 30 seconds or something like that, maybe 4 minutes. And we'd, you know, the bat light would go on. People would slide down the pole into the bat cave, out into the streets of Gotham with the ambulance. If you have a kid on the farm, maybe a teenager, and they're wanting to learn to do something, and they want to do something heavy in the world, come on. And so, but you don't really want to send them into a war zone. Well, how about if you go and learn to be an emergency medical technician, and you can ride with the ambulance? So maybe if you're an EMT on the farm, you might see some Band-Aids or somebody with a sprained knee, but you go to the South Bronx and you're dealing with gunshot wounds and stabbings and, you know, knife fights and broken glass fights and all that stuff, several a night. And so they got an instant training. The Wall Street Journal called them the Braid Brigade. And you know, it was nice. It was a good few years doing that. And eventually what they did was they set up a school and began training people in the South Bronx. It was a green jobs program, if you will, where people could learn to be paramedics and learn to run ambulance. And actually, we taught a different style than the kind that most ambulances in the city at that time were trained in. Those were all owned by private funeral homes at that time. There was no emergency medical service in New York, in any of the five boroughs. And so the private, obviously they had a separate interest, and we taught basics like stabilize before transport. So those kinds of things, that was actually a very valuable, those skill sets. And when the city got shamed into having its own emergency medical system, our people started getting hired out of our school really quick. And we really could train up a lot of people. Today, if you go to New York City and you go through the emergency medical system hierarchy, the catalog of who's working in that field, a lot of those people were trainees or had lived at the farm and are still there today running the system for the city. And that was actually one where we had an end game and we could withdraw after a few years and come back to the farm and call it mission accomplished. We don't have to do this anymore. Belize, this is one we're still working in. It's a very poor country. It's had a lot of unfortunate governments, a lot of mishaps and a lot of mismanagement of funds. And we're working with ecotourism and ecological design. I teach a permaculture course there every year. That's usually in March. This year it'll be February 24th to March 3rd. And it's a very nice place to teach permaculture because it's a very good example of existing agroforestry projects that have been going for 20 years. We feed a class of 30 or 40 people. The entire class gets fed from within about 100 yards of the kitchen for 2 weeks. And you know, it's very well managed, and it's all done in very low labor intense systems of perennial crops. And We teach that on a ruin, on a mountain that was where 20 in 1920s they found the crystal skull. And anytime you kick over a stone, it's like a piece of a building that was there 800 years ago or something. And so anybody who wants to come to the Maya world in 2012 and learn permaculture where they found the crystal skull, come on down. So we also were active in peace movement, still are. We have a group called Peace Roots, and we put up these signs around the country. Some of you may have seen them. We put about 50 of these up back in before the Iraq War, trying to change the framing of the peace movement. We also had a program, we still have a program called More Than Warmth, where this woman, Judy, goes around to low-income neighborhoods and shelters and has kids make quilts, teaches kids to make quilts. A lot of them are orphans. And she will go to Afghanistan or Iraq with the quilts and to go to orphanages there and say, here's some warm quilts for you guys. They were made by kids in the United States who also don't have parents, but they heard you guys get cold. All right, so thinking about what are the roots of peace? What are the roots of peace? And it works generationally. So you can either make jihadists in your foreign policy, or you can make friends with simple person-to-person citizen diplomacy. Peace through permaculture. This is the Middle East. This is Shmuel and Allison are green kibbutzniks. They're working with my friend Murad Al-Kufash, who does the permaculture training center in Marta. And they're on two sides of the green line. And yet, they are both concerned for peace, and both concerned for future generations, and both concerned for what the future of that part of the world will be. And through permaculture, they see ways to make inroads into what otherwise would seem like an impossible relationship. When Hurricane Katrina hit, we were watching on television like most everybody else. And we had a fella call up from Santa Cruz, Gary, who had been on the bus caravan. And Gary says, Albert, or he says, Peter, actually. Peter was in the plenty office. He says, Peter, we're watching this on TV. Is the farm sending anybody down to New Orleans? And we said, I don't know, Gary. He says, well, why don't you send some buses? And we said, well, we haven't any buses in the farm in 30 years, Gary. And so Gary flew from Santa Cruz, used his credit card, and bought a school bus, and went from in Nashville. Then he came down to the farm. We loaded him up with all the apprentices at the Eco Village Training Center and sent him down to New Orleans. This is the day three. And so they get through the outer ring of police and into New Orleans and deliver packages of stuff we sent from the farm, turn around, come back. Next trip, they make it through again. Third trip there, the National Guard has arrived. They've cordoned off the city. We can't go in. So we run the blockade through various ways using little tricks like letters from the UN. We find this guy named Alfred, who's in the Ninth Ward. Alfred was a former Black Panther in Oakland, and he's now living in the Ninth Ward. Well, he was going around and collecting dead bodies and bringing them to his yard and covering them with tin. So we said, you the man. And we gave him everything we had, water, toilet paper, everything like that, and he's our forward base. And so then we had to keep him supplied. How do we keep him supplied? Back in Tennessee, we were joined by Cindy Crawford and the Veterans for Peace. They had decamped from Camp Crawford in Texas, and we're setting up a new camp in Coventry, Louisiana. And so we use them as another shuttle to keep stuff coming from Tennessee and smuggle it through the National Guard lines, doing basic Civil War technology of running the blockades to get in through into New Orleans and keep Alfred supplied. We also hooked up with the Port of Chien Indian tribe, which is a state-recognized tribe there, roughly 700 members in the bayou. And they lost a lot in Katrina. I don't have the sound on here, but they also were very badly damaged by the Macondo oil spill. So we've been working with them through that whole experience and providing whatever we can to volunteers, gifts, comfort, whatever, you know, we can supply. We find ourselves going to these places like the Haitian earthquake, Macondo, the Katrina, and we keep encountering like Mother Teresa's Sisters of Charity and some others. We're part of a group of people that seems to want to respond to these things. And maybe it's futile, but we go to the places that really need the most. And what we find there is a camaraderie of people who are doing the same thing, who all see the immediate urgent need and are just reaching out to help out. And it's like, it's just a human instinct to go out and try and help when you see somebody's in trouble. And why more people don't do it, I don't know. Sometimes we're supported in this work and sometimes we're impeded in this work, but we do it anyway. And this is my training center in Tennessee. We're doing courses and workshops, so we empower people and give them activist skills. This is Eco-Village Network of the Americas. There's a long story there. Doing workshops in Colombia during the Colombian Civil War, being assisted by the military to keep us away from the guerrillas. Working basically in these concepts of sustainability. What does it really mean? It has to be economically sustainable. It has to be socially sustainable. And so as we go through and we learn these things, we also learn about transition and we learn about how you move from where you are now to where you're going to be some years in the future. We started working with the USDA to get programs into our local area. We call it the Local Economic Development and Green Initiative. These are all programs that we're doing in Hohenwald, Tennessee. They don't believe in climate change. They don't believe in peak oil. It doesn't matter. They believe in green jobs. They believe in economic improvements. We can work with that. We work with a countywide carbon negative initiative. I can talk more about that when we get some time. We had the 10th Continental Bioregional Congress at the farm. I also go to events outside the farm like the climate conference in Copenhagen, the climate conference in Cancun, working with the United Nations agencies as Committee for Sustainable Development, Habitat, and so forth, trying to get some of these initiatives going worldwide. This is a course that we teach. We do workshops all over the place, and this is the one that we did this year in Belize. Just to bring it around to the farm and in conclusion, this is where we are today. This is the shape of the center of the farm. And my training center is right here in the middle. This part here used to be all different kinds of houses and stuff, and roads and water systems and electrical systems. And about 1975, we got to the point where we realized that if our goal of management for this amount of land is biodiversity, then we need larger chunks of wilderness. And large animals, you need to have larger pieces. And migration routes and things like that. So we deconstructed roads and houses all over this whole part of the land and consolidated to this side of the creek and turned this over into wilderness. This is now wilderness. Plus, we then started acquiring more land to add on to that wilderness sector so that we could manage for biodiversity. So this is what we look like. And we're surrounded by forestry companies, mostly paper and pulp. Southeastern United States is being raked over now for hardwoods to go into paper and pulp. And so I'm loving digital publishing, but paper publishing is still a bane, and a lot of it's still happening. This is what happens in Tennessee after they've been through a landscape. This is what they leave behind. There's not a lot of regulation. We get 50 inches of annual rainfall. It makes a mess of things. There's all that soil just going down into the rivers. So we look at this, and this is how we were in 1971. 1972, we added a second chunk. That was how it stayed for 20 or more years. Then we started adding on more. And as we could save up some money, we did some kind of subscription purchases where we put out the word and we said, okay, if we can get 400 people to put up $1,000, we can buy this chunk, you know, and that kind of thing. And you can earn off your subscription. We'll give you different kinds of things. So we gradually added on these pieces. In 2002, we got this last missing chunk that gave us a corridor. This is what we have, about 5,000 acres under management now. We're going for 25,000 acres for the whole Swan River watershed. And partly that's to protect wildlife and to give some resiliency. Partly it's also as a climate change anticipatory buffer to be able to have work with large systems and to protect from climate change. So we're starting to look at water. How does water, how does the aquifer recharge? Can we put more water systems in? Can we build ponds? Can we build lakes? How does that work? So we started learning about carbon farming, giving courses in carbon farming. Nowadays we're doing key lining where we go through the fields, we inject biochar, we inject minerals, rock dust, we inject compost teas, and we have large compost tea brewers on the back of pickup trucks that can go right out in the field, make huge batches of compost tea, and then put that into the fields with something like a key line plow, and build, you can, doing this system, you can build a meter of soil in 10 years, meter deep, black soil, anywhere. So that's what we're doing, reestablishing the soil biology. And that builds resilience. That makes you more able to handle droughts, more able to handle major infestations and fires and things. So reestablishing our water systems, et cetera. So every now and then we revisit our vision and our mission as a community. And the latest iteration of that mission statement was, we've decided our purpose is to provide a physical place, secure financially and politically, ecologically healthy and open to the sky, to pursue fulfillment in life, whatever that means to a given individual. So it's broad, but it basically states why we're there. It also means that we have a responsibility to natural systems. So this is Eggert's sunflower. Eggert's sunflower only grows in the Highland Rim of Middle Tennessee, specifically at the farm. There are a few other remnants outside the farm, but mostly it's on the farm. So within our 5,000 acres, this is the only place on the planet left for Helianthus eggerti. Our responsibility to the species, what do we even know about this species? No medicinal value, no food value. It is a pollen plant, that obviously there's a pollinator there, but what does it do? Can't really say, but it has a right. It has a natural right. It has a right to existence. And what right do we have to do anything that would exterminate it? We actually have an obligation to protect it anytime we find it, to set off that area and protect it and provide it for it what it needs. Here's another one, summer tanager. We're the northern extent of its flyway, and that's going to change. But right now it starts in Peru and comes up to us and goes back down to Peru. So we need to protect the habitat that that bird needs. That's actually a sacred obligation. We can't take it away. So we have unfinished work to do, and more people coming all the time. It's a little tricky to find places to live, but we have a new water tower up. The old water tower lasted as long as 30 years and eventually rusted out, but we have a new one up. And when Rigoberto Menchu won the Nobel Prize, people went back to Guatemala from Mexico, and they're now living there, and we're resuming some work with those projects that we had started. And we're also doing a little historical preservation. So sometimes we get student groups coming into the farm and helping us to protect and preserve some of these historical artifacts for the Farm Historical Society. Thank you very much.